minutes before we start. We're here, obviously, to celebrate Jeremy Yudkin. He's here with his family today, Kathleen and me. Susanna, Bobby, and Daniel are here as well, which we're very happy about. Just quickly, thank yous. This event wouldn't be possible without the support of the library board, our development office, Jenny Ray, and Maria Lynch, who actually made this event happen. Months ago, we planned this event. It was not planned as a fundraiser. It really was just to celebrate what Jeremy has accomplished in 40 years and all of his other accomplishments as well. It turned out to be a tremendous fundraiser for the library and its operating expenses and programs. So thank you to all of you, our major sponsors, and all the ticket holders here today. You all contributed, so thank you. Jeremy selected some musicians that you'll listen to today that are very dear to him. He also asked some good friends and colleagues to speak to you today, and I think you'll really enjoy this program. It should probably go for an hour and a half. And without further ado, I will turn it over to Chris for some news.
We've gotten to know each other pretty well over the last few years, and it took Jeremy Yudkin to make me a distinguished lecturer. My mother was so proud. She was just as proud as she is circumspect. But and I, who am the last person on the planet to be confidently opining on any piece of music at all, attended my first lecture with Jeremy, where he did a very deep dive into Beethoven's Fifth. And after that, I said, this is so accessible to someone like me. And I felt like you spoke just in a gifted way, and it's something that everyone should have the experience of being a part of, and you've been a part of that for 40 years. So I hope you find when I speak about town government, it's just as captivating. I sense that it's not. But there is a passion that you and I both share, and it's for the game of football. European football. So in that vein, we have something special for you. How difficult it was for me to do this, all the way from England.
Wow.
Oh, yes!
Jeremy's favorite football team is Tottenham Hotspur from North London. And
Thank you. Jeremy's role as writer in residence at the Lenox Library. source material, the archives of the Music Inn from Stephanie Barber. Now, Jeremy claims that it's due to his efforts that we now have them at the library. I did visit Stephanie, and she received me in pink satin pajamas, so I would like to think I had a little to do with it, but I'll give the credit to Jeremy. He had the archives in this room. He had this will tell you how long ago it was, he had a connection, e-proxy connection to BU, and he would load to me all the databases that he had access to that our little public library did not. He had JSTOR. So he wrote the book in this office, and on the door was that, you know, the spray painted frosting on the glass to give him privacy, and scrawled on it is Bab's place on the door. It's because you, Jeremy, is it because your mother wanted you to be a girl and was going to name you Barbara?
Yes.
So I'm so glad that we could gather today to honor Jeremy, to honor him as impresario, as author, and as professor. So welcome and thank you for joining us today.
I am honored to be here to honor Mr. Yudkin. I think I met Jeremy and Catherine, it must have been maybe now, I'm going to say 15 years ago or so, at the Egremont Inn. And I had been coming to the area for a while, but had just been working at the former Egremont Inn, which is no longer with us. I will remember you said something that has stayed with me, and I was so touched that it went, I must be doing something the way I expected it. But you said I was an authentic singer, and that touched me more than you'll ever know, because it's my goal, it's what I want to do and what I want to be, and I kind of want to be an authentic human too, but that doesn't always work. And the songs that you picked, like I said, we need to talk, because you picked songs that I learned at my great-grandmother's knee, so especially this first one, which comes from, it's from the early jazz age, and this is Nobody Knows You.
Once I lived the life of a million.
my great grandmother was Missy D. Brown, and she was a honky tonk piano player around the turn of the century. She was born in 1900, and she was quite the character. Now, when I got to know her, she was a church lady with big hats. But I heard her voice, and while I was singing that, because I learned that song from her, so thank you for that. That was really lovely. This one as well. This is a spiritual that I learned that I grew up singing, and to this day still sing. I had the pleasure of doing a one-woman show about Marian Anderson, and this is one of the spirituals that she sang in her song. This is Motherless Child.
Oh.
a song I've never, ever sung before. And it makes me, it gives me great joy because it's going to be a song that I will sing never again. So thank you for this one. It's a song by Bob Dylan. Actually. And it's Forever Young. May you be, may you stay forever young.
Forever young. his glittering array of anecdotes to talk about Jeremy. And I'm here to offer my thanks and appreciation for so many years of great dedication and insight. But I wanted to do some pretty crude math first, because I thought 40 years, and that's 8 weeks of Tanglewood concerts per season, and three programs every week. That's about 960 programs. There are probably three or four pieces. So we're approaching 2,800 pieces that Jeremy spoke about in great detail. It doesn't quite work like that, and Jeremy's approach is far more sophisticated and far more intelligent and alluring than that, as attested by Chris's comment about the deep dive in debate open fine. And I know I've stuck into the back of a few of your talks over the years, Jeremy, but I take note very carefully of what you choose to speak about. And you just aim for certain things throughout the course of a Tanglewood season that I perhaps wouldn't have thought of as being among the most interesting, everything's interesting, but of particular appeal. But you often talk about it in ways which enlighten it for those of us at all levels of musical acumen and understanding. And also, you're an impartial commentator, which I greatly appreciate. Sometimes those of us who are in the middle of planning a season and seeing it out get so caught up that there are things we often miss. And over the years, Jeremy's talked about connections between pieces within programs across the season that I hadn't even imagined were there. And so for that, I thank you. But I also, you are a tangible sign of this great long history between the Lenox Library and Tanglewood going back to the 1940s. And Amy referenced a Bernstein concert, and of course they were famous events with Leonard Bernstein and Lucas Foss and other luminaries at the very beginning of their careers, and Jeremy has brought light back on those over the years. We had a lovely event for John Williams' 90th birthday last year, and as I just mentioned, we look forward to celebrating Koussevitzky's 150th next year. So this is a long history, and you are in many ways the spokesperson for this great connection between our institutions. So, forever young, and we look forward to another 40 years. I won't do the math again. Thank you, Jeremy, for all of your dedication.
Thank you. So, you know, I have notes here, actually, I wrote out, so I just sent an email to say, you know, speak for 2 or 3 minutes, no more than three. Right, you know, so, and it's a challenge to do that, but I just want to acknowledge the fact that it's a great honor to be here in celebration of Jeremy. He's just a force, and I think we're here to celebrate him and acknowledge this moment. I'm not going to talk about Boston University really at all. I've learned my lessons over the years that there was one event where I sort of sang someone's praises. They're like, that was so nice, I'm going to retire. So we need you, Jeremy. We need you. You know, and of course, but 2 or 3 minutes is not really long enough you know, to sort of actually spend enough time talking about, you know, what a wonderful and impactful and amazing force Jeremy Yudkin is. But I think that all of us can take some time and sort of talk about, you know, Jeremy and the impact he's had on us and on Lenox and FPU as well. And if we did that, we'd be here for weeks upon weeks upon weeks. And it'd be the June of Jeremy, the July of Jeremy, the August of Jeremy. It'd be amazing, but people have to go home and get that. So 20 years ago, I'm a historian, just so you know. So 20 years ago, there was an article in July 2003 in the Berkshire Eagle by Stephanie Cohen. And it's called Classical Music is for Everyone. And it was a profile, it was a full-page profile of Jeremy Yudkin. And that sticks out for me. It was 20 years ago. So at that point, Jeremy had been giving these lectures for about 20 years. So it's like, you know, from today's perspective, kind of happening, right? And there were three things that registered for me. The first is his smile, right? You know, there, and I'll say a bit more about that a little later, but you see a picture over there of the even younger you, you know. And so there was that. The second part, you know, that sticks with me, you know, is the fact that it's a reminder of just what a force Jeremy has been within this region's community for the past 40 years. I mean, if you think about some of the changes that have occurred, the BSO, Boston University, you know, the changes of CEOs, of presidents, of musical directors, of deans, right? It's Jeremy who has been a force, he's been present, he's been a through line, he's been here, right? And that's really important and powerful. And the third thing about that article is it actually, this is why it's a feature-length article about Jeremy, it encourages everyone, all the readers, to take the time to spend, to take the time to spend with you, Jeremy, right? To allow themselves to be open to explorations, to allow their curiosity, your leadership, your mentorship, your mastery of knowledge, you know, to be imparted upon them, and to have their lives profoundly changed. You know, so there's a lot of things we can say about Jeremy Yudkin. I mean, of course, he is a extraordinary scholar, the author of so many cited articles and books. He is a force. Yes, he has this sort of knowledge that is deep and capacious that like makes everyone envious and involved. How can that possibly be? He has this analytical mind. You know, he is a person who orchestrated this event and the programming as well. He saw Bob Dylan's Forever Young. He is a person who has led with great distinction. He has these amazing administrative chops, whether it's the musicology department, whether it's the Beethoven Research Center at BU. He has done so many, so many things for us. And of course, there's his smile, right? There is his infectious smile. It's disarming, actually. It makes you lean in. It gives you a sense of trust and to say, I want to spend more time with this person. And in that disarming smile, you know, that's like grim. Jeremy, what happens is we allow our guard to go down, right? We allow ourselves to become vulnerable. You know, we allow ourselves to be impressed upon, and therefore we create the space for us to learn and to be guided by him. And that is what he's done for so many of us, you know, for 40 years. Now, of course, you know, Jeremy is an exceptional scholar, but he's also a master teacher. You know, he's a person who enters each room, not with ego, but with compassion. You know, and I want to repeat that, because that's a really rare thing, you know, to find. A person who enters a room, not with ego, with compassion. You know, his commitment is to make sure that other people find the same joy, the same sense of excitement, the same sense of self-fulfillment and self-discovery that he himself has found. You know, and that is rare, and that's extraordinary. What Jeremy is he is a person, a scholar, a researcher of the highest caliber. So he's a person, if you've been in rooms, I've been in rooms with him, you know, with the foremost Beethoven scholars, or Bob Dylan scholars, or Beatles scholars. I'm talking about people who spend time in the archives, they've written, you know, books and articles, stuff like that. He is the foremost scholar among them. They line up to talk to Jeremy, to learn from Jeremy Yudkin. But he's also a person who wants to lean in and open himself up and welcome in those people who have no experience with music. You know, people who might even confide and confess, you know what, I don't think I like classical music. And he will actually sit down with that person, and through the lectures, through conversation, he will nurture, he will ignite a spark of curiosity and wonder in those individuals. So that article from 2003, right, Classical Music is for Everyone, which is a profile of Jeremy Yudkin, is a reminder of the fact that he is actually that hook. He is the person who reminds us that indeed, music is for everyone. You know, and I think that's a rare, extraordinary accomplishment. The last thing I want to say is just, I want to end these remarks by talking about beginnings. You know, what Jeremy does is he, when he has lectures, what he often will do in his lectures is he will talk about how a movement begins. Right? He wants to equip his students, the listener, with a way of sort of onboarding, understanding the complexities, the rigor, you know, of the composition that, you know, that they're going to experience. And what he does is, by focusing upon beginnings, he hooks you in, right? He helps you realize that, yes, you too can interpret and understand the complexities of music, that you too have this sort of inherent excitement and desire and love and passion for music. And what he does in this commitment to beginnings is that he not only launches a person's curiosity for that performance or for that program, but it's also a curiosity that will last them for a lifetime. You know, so for launching so many people, you know, making them curious for a lifetime, Jeremy Yudkin.
Thank you so much, Jeremy, for having me tonight. I really appreciate it. Put me up here and have you play one of my favorite songs, which is great. Then I'll change the program. I am going to be playing I've Just Seen a Face instead of I Feel Fine. One of McCartney's finest. So we'll see how that goes. One last thing before I start. My family and Jeremy's family have known each other my whole life, for the most part. And I don't know a lot of your work, I'm sorry to say, but I know you as a person, and I now know how many people you've touched, and how inspiring it can be to be you, and I'm just kind of awestruck at how many people you've brought together here, and yeah, you've inspired me today, so thank you for that.
But other girls were never quite like this. La, da, 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 da. congratulations on a great day. Your mom and dad were proud. Jeremy, congratulations.
And thank you.
I'm really quite honored to be here. I'm overwhelmed by not only the crowd, but this fabulous music. I can't sing, I can't dance, I played the trumpet for 12 years, although I probably couldn't play a tune today. But I was surrounded by music growing up. And these pianists really, it got very emotional for me because I was thinking of my mom. My mom loved to play the piano. She was self-taught. She learned to play the piano by ear, which was really quite a gift in itself. She spoke four languages, but she learned to play the piano by ear. It wasn't until years later that she actually learned to read music. But Claire de Lune was one of her favorite tunes of all time. And I hear that, I had that on my playlist. And I can't help but think of my mom, and I think she's probably looking down very happily that we're honoring Jeremy and his gift to not only Lenox, but to the Berkshires. And I'm really quite honored. For those folks who are new or newer to Lenox or the Berkshires, growing up here, I have to tell you, General Electric was going strong in Pittsfield. 10 or 12,000 people working every day up there. The paper mills all throughout the Berkshires were employing thousands of other people. And we had this place called Tanglewood that opened up on the 4th of July, and I could walk here today, and I'm glad I didn't because of the thunder and lightning talking right now. I live right down the street, and on the 4th of July and on the weekends, my siblings and I would sit on the wall at Windsor Mountain High School, which is now BUTI, and we would play the license plate game. Because it was such a different change of the traffic in the Berkshires. Now, to be found very honest with you, come Labor Day, we were saying, okay, enough, go home. We had enough. But when General Electric started to cut back and the paper mill started to close down, I'm so proud of the town of Lenox and the visionary leaders of that time, and Chris Ketchum and Boris Buckner continuing on that fine tradition. We started to double down on the cultural economy. South County became a cultural mecca. I really believe in the last 20 or 30, even 40 years. Now, and I think Jeremy's got a lot to do with that because we saw the shift. We saw the economic shift. And we saw an opportunity to become a world-class, worldwide destination called the Berkshires. Now, I'm very selfish about Lenox because this is where I live, but I look at the South Berkshires, and I'm being selfish again because it's my district. We are a destination for people from all over the world to come here. We're rich with culture. We're rich with culture. Filthy rich. I served on the Culture Development Committee, and I've been on the committee for probably 15 of the 21 years I've been in the legislature. And we had our very first hearing out here in the Berkshires in the gallery of the Norman Rockwell Museum. My colleagues from Boston, who several of them never, ever in their life made it out to the Berkshires until that day, learned firsthand how special the Berkshires are and how rich we are with the culture and how far we stretch a dollar with that cultural investment. Think about it now, and I'd love to have a show of hands. How many people would give me a dollar right now knowing you would get $10 in return tomorrow? That's what our cultural economy in Massachusetts does. It's the third largest industry in Massachusetts, and I would argue it's the economic engine of the Berkshires. And we need to get Tanglewood and Tony to stretch out those seasons a little bit longer, but you know, we look at the Colonial Theater and Shakespeare and Company and the Mahaley Theater, and I tell you, it's endless. There's not a night that goes by that you couldn't partake in some richness of the Berkshires, and I think that's what's really pretty special. So, Jeremy, I want to thank you for all that you've done, not only for the Lenox Library, bringing attention to this beautiful building that we have in the center of Lenox, but bringing attention to the town of Lenox, which we all love near and dear, but also bringing cultural, the richness of culture to the Berkshires. You are a staple, you're an unsung hero of the Berkshire cultural economy. And I'd love to have you come up here. I've got a little presentation for you. This is a citation from the House of Representatives that I've been told allows you free parking at Tanglewood. Hereby known to all that the Massachusetts House of Representatives offers its sincerest congratulations to Jeremy Yudkin in recognition of your contribution to the arts and partnership with the Lenox community for over 40 years. The entire membership extends its very best wishes and expresses a hope for future good fortune and continued continued success in all endeavors, given this 25th day of June, 2023, signed by the Speaker of the House, Ron Mariano, and very proudly by your state representative, the more importantly, your friends, many big friends.
Pleasure to be part of this. Thank you so much for having us. And what a pleasure to hear everybody else as well. Very inspiring. I saw this request from Jeremy. I was thrilled. This is one of my favorite singer-songwriters. Of course, my number one favorite singer-songwriter is Bobby Sweet. Number two on that list is Joni Mitchell, the wonderful Joni Mitchell. So, for you, Jeremy.
They're all in tune when you buy them. Folk music.
And flows of angel hair and ice cream castles in the air and battered canyons everywhere. I've looked at clouds that way, but now they only block the sun. They rain and snow. Clouds got in my way.
Have you looked at clouds from both sides now? From up and down, and still somehow, it's clouds and illusions I recall. I really don't know clouds at all.
And tunes and Ferris wheels, a dizzy dancing way you feel when every fairy tale comes real. I looked at love that way, but now it's just another show. You leave them laughing. Don't give yourself away. Tears and fears and feeling proud to say I love you right above. Dreams and schemes and circus crowds. I've looked at life that way, but now old friends are acting strange. they shake their heads. They say I changed, but something's lost and something's gained. Living every day.
Western music, and I come from a long line of folk musicians. My great-grandfather was a well-known fiddle player and square dance caller in the 30s, 40s, 50s, and had newspaper articles at home talking about when the BSO first came to Lenox, Berkshire Symphonic Festival, is that what it was called? Before the shed, I guess there was a tent and a lot of people were just outside. And they called my great-grandfather because he was the leading folk expressionist of this area. He lived just over the line in Austerlitz, New York. So they called him to go on down and meet Mr. Kusevitsky. And the paper interviewed my great-grandfather, who was named Pop Sweet. And they said, well, how did you find Mr. Kusevitsky? And he said, well, he's a very nice gentleman, and he certainly handles that wand in one hand magnificently, but I don't know why he can't handle at least a piccolo in the other. That about sums it up. He was a teller of tall tales, played for Franklin D. Roosevelt, taught at the St. Vincent Millay to square dance, with whom he shared the first citizen of Austerlitz. And also taught Ted Shawn how to dance the Virginia Reel. And this is another Jeremy's request here, and I was surprised by this one because, as I said, I grew up with old-time country music. I mean, those beautiful, old, wonderful, horribly depressing songs. My dad sang all those when I was a kid, and this is one of the ones that he sang. And no afternoon of music is complete without a great cheating murder hanging song. And I couldn't figure out where Jeremy must have come across this tune, but well, we can have fun with this one now.
I spoke not a word, these hills and a long black veil. She visits my grave when the night winds wail. Nobody knows, nobody sees.
Music with a single smile. You became
appealed to my inner conscience. He asked me, do you really want to play the piano?
And I said, yeah, I really do. And then we worked together to kind of come up with a plan to make that happen. And eventually the music became its own reward, and now I've been playing the piano for 25 years. And this is really how my dad gave me the gift of music. He had the vision to see my potential, and he had the patience to work with me to support that. And I think he's done something similar with the town of Lenox. 40 years ago, my dad saw an opportunity to help people better appreciate the Tanglewood music concerts. And he since then has given thousands of people an opportunity to connect more deeply to this music, this incredibly special form of art. A few years after that, 16 years ago, he saw an opportunity to connect people, to introduce people to some of the leading thinkers, some of the leading scholars in the Berkshires, and also to build a better, stronger sense of community in the Berkshires as well, and that turned into the Distinguished Lecture Series. And then, you know, who thinks to throw a Beatles tribute concert in Lenox Town Hall? That is vision to me. That is the vision to see and imagine something outlandish, something amazing, something beautiful, and then the patience and the determination to turn that from an idea into a reality. And so this is another way in which my dad has sort of manifested these qualities, the gardener's qualities of vision and patience. But of course, there were some dry spells, some times when it was not so easy. I remember one time my dad was considering just doing the pre-concert lectures for free just to kind of bring people in the door. And there were other times when my whole family was kind of pitching in. So my mom would be collecting emails, my sister would be giving out cookies, and my job was to kind of be the grunt who lugged the speakers in from the car into the library. But eventually, you know, thanks to my dad's determination, and thanks to the Lenox Library, the town of Lenox, and of course some really diehard fans, people that my dad has cultivated over the years, people who truly love my dad, we've managed to turn the pre-concert lectures into a permanent fixture in the town, and that's just so, so exciting and amazing. And nowadays, you know, my dad is essentially like an institution in the Berkshires. I really can't go anywhere without someone seeing my last name and being like, oh, Yudkin, are you related to Jeremy somehow? Yes, I'm his son, you know, thank you. It's simultaneous, like, it's a mixed of feelings when that happens, you know. I feel proud, but also, like, can I go anywhere without people, like, calling me up for having that name? So, anyway, I'm just so thrilled to be able to honor my dad. We're so proud of him. I'm seriously so proud of my dad. To just see and hear all these amazing people say so many wonderful things about him. So just want to say, you know, to look at my dad, and this is someone who truly had the vision to see what was possible, and then the patience to help all of us to see that too. So, thank you, Daddy.
Very tempted to decline.
But when I heard it was to be a fundraiser for the library, I was all in. I've been involved in the library for 40 years. But to be asked to be a conduit for fundraising for this library is a very great honor for me. So this is really not about me, but it is about the library, which is the heart and soul of Lenox. The number of programs put on by the library is truly remarkable, including Terry Ullaberry concerts in the park, outside story time for kids, outside bathing circle, virtual author talks, the Distinguished Lecture Library series, a creative writing group for grades 6 to 12, folk drumming and singing, author visits, Tanglewood Talks, the book club, and this is not to mention the book collection, the CDs and DVDs, and the collection of audio books that the library has for loan. And museum passes for events during the summer. And how wonderful the weekly homebound delivery and pickup program for people who cannot leave their homes and have books brought to them and picked up from them. I'd very much like to thank the sponsors of this event who contributed most generously to the fundraiser. All my friends who came, musicians who donated their time happily and their talents for this afternoon, all the speakers who have spoken so kindly and flatteringly about my contributions. I'd like to thank Ed Richter, the president of the library board, the members of the board, Amy Fave, local history librarian, Lenox town manager, Chris Ketchum, Tony Ford from the BSO, state reps Mitty Pegmatelli, and Dr. Harvey Young, who came all the way from Boston and his responsibilities as Dean of the College of Fine Arts just for this event. And the library staff, especially Amy, who was the first person I met at the library 40 years ago and showed me the collection of 78s and LPs that the library had. And talk to me about the library's connection with Tanglewood. I'd like to thank the director, Katie O'Neill, who, as Amy said, was not able to be here, and the members of the committee who put on this event, and Jenny Ray and Maria Lynch, especially, who have been working on this event for the whole of the last year, and who have organized it with such collegiality and tact. Thank you. They say that behind every great man is a great woman. I'm not a great man, but I am married to a great woman. She helped raise our children with patience, understanding, and tremendous insight. And if you want to get an idea of her brilliance at this difficult and vitally important task, just spend a couple of minutes with our wonderful children. One of whom you've seen already, Daniel, and our wonderful daughter, Susanna, who's right there. Both are spending their lives in the pursuit of helping others and making this world a better place. Catherine held down the fort while I was jetting around to Paris, or Vienna or St. Petersburg, giving lectures, or hunkered down in my study, barely talking for months or sometimes even years, working on my next article or my next book. And in the meantime, this remarkable woman has earned two master's degrees, taught languages for 25 years, and has now, with extraordinary dedication and hard work, turned herself into a jazz and cabaret singer. Catherine, you're the best. Thank you all.